All right, gang, welcome to the Keep It Metal Show right here on Rock Attic Radio. I have Joe from Liege Lord on the line. Joe, how you doing, man?
Good, Billy. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, no problem, no problem, man. I appreciate you calling in today. Now give us a little bit of history about Liege Lord, man. When did it all start? When did it all begin?
Well, Matt and Tony basically started the band in 1984. Was shifting from Mega Waves, but originally they started the band and got signed, and the first album, Freedom's Rise, came out. Got a lot of attention and success, especially in Europe. And then the band got signed to Medway. Joe DeMansfuego had heard about the band. I guess, the Connecticut scene was, Liege Lord was really turning it on its head, I guess, so to speak. And Metal Blade signed the band, and they released Burn to My Touch with the addition of introducing Paul Nelson on guitar. And then I'm not really sure what the situation with Andy Michaud was, but the band was really looking for a new direction, but maybe a new direction vocally, and they put out auditions, and I got the gig, and we released Master Control on Metal Blade, 1988, and then with, all these label problems, and, budgets, and just, it's not like we were, looking to make a killing, man. We just wanted to be successful and put our music out there and be able to play, but also be able to, survive and not live on the streets, and there just really wasn't any money, and the deal we were offered for the next contract was like 7 albums, and it just, wouldn't have worked. So the band went its ways. We've been friends over the years and always knew that we'd revisit the music. I don't think anyone thought, because Matt and Tony were doing other things and I was doing other things, but especially Matt and Tony weren't involved in the metal scene as much anymore. I was, because they went on to play in a bunch of bands, but I don't think anyone could foresee we would not only revisit the music, but be so excited about it and want to do a new album and, continue with it where we left off, which is a really cool and exciting time period for us right now.
Cool, man. Very cool. So now, tell us about the songwriting. Is it a one-person effort? Is it a group effort? How do you guys go about doing that?
Well, I guess, the past was the past, so there's really no sense of speaking about that. I did come in the band when I did the Master Control album, and I wrote lyrics for 3 songs, but I wrote all the vocal melodies and harmonies and everything, all the lines. Matt wrote the rest of the lyrics, but I came up with all the melodies and harmonies. Music was split up between mostly Matt and Tony, but Paul did write 3 tunes. For the new stuff, it's going to be a collaborative effort where we bring, now we've got Frank and Danny in the band, 2 new members, and we're just going to throw ideas in the pot. Obviously, the core is, has been Tony, Matt, and myself, but, we just want the best possible music, so if, Frank or Danny brings something to the table that's just crushing, obviously we're going to use that and work on that, but I think it's going to be a collaborative thing, and we're going to bring ideas to the table, and now that we're kind of all centrally located, not too far from each other, we're going to get together and jam as well and see what we come up with.
Cool, very cool, man. Now, how would you describe your sound to people?
Classic metal. It's got the roots there, the priest, the maiden, all that stuff except. But we always had like this thrash, like a newer cutting edge kind of thrash power metal thing. I don't know. We've been, people have quoted, their opinion of us as saying we're the founders of that kind of power metal thing. It's an honor to be said. I don't know if that's true, but that's a really cool tag that we've gotten. So, just going back, I guess we're going to, we'll always keep our roots, the early, we have a British heavy metal and the priest and the maiden stuff, but I think it's got a harder, thrashier New York edge, East Coast edge to it, and we're going to continue in that vein. We're going to stay true to our roots, but we do want to get fresh and ahead, and so we'll just see what comes out of it, We're not going to be stuck in the past, but yet we're not going to abandon what we've grown up listening to.
Cool, very cool. I think somebody else chimed in.
up, Billy? Frank Gilchrist here.
Hey, Frank, how you doing, man?
Pretty good. How are you?
Not too bad. So I guess, Frank, you're one of the new guys in the band. How's that going for you so far?
Oh, it's going great. Having a blast. It's like I've been playing with these guys my whole life.
Great.
Hey, Frank. Hey, Joe.
So now, here's a question for each of you. You guys played a lot of live shows. What would you guys say are the best and the worst things about playing the live gigs?
Well, for me, the gig is the coolest. The rest of it sometimes can suck. To be honest. The tour, you know, the traveling, the waiting around, the, you know, because it's metal and it's at a certain level, sometimes the venues aren't really up to par. You know, the whole all filthy kind of deal. You know what I mean? But it's all worth it because at the end of the day, when we, you know, five of us walk on stage, it's cool. It's what we live for. You know, so
cool. Frank,
and the good with the bad.
But yeah, for me, I would say the same thing Joe said. You know, the great part is playing the music, interacting with the fans, meeting people to tell you how much your music means to them and stuff, and all that. That's kind of like a communion of souls, you know. Everybody's just a good vibe. Everybody's celebrating heavy metal, and then of course, you know, the bad side is traveling and waiting around, and no telephones, no internet, no cell phones. This, you know, you're trapped in them sometimes in the middle of nowhere, and, you know, it's a little disorienting sometimes. I got cut off when we went to Germany. I got cut off from all my bank accounts for a couple of days. I couldn't get any money. And it was crazy stuff happened.
Yeah. All right. So when did you guys first get into music? And when did you know that this is what you wanted to do for a living?
Well, I guess for me, Joe here, I guess it was, you know, there was inklings of things like Aerosmith and Frampton, but basically it was Kiss. You know, I got my first Kiss album. It's like, man, these guys are cool. These guys are like, you know, Marvel comic star, you know, superhero.
Yeah.
And this is really the first time I saw live, you know, because there was no videos and stuff like that. This is the first time I saw actual instruments in guys' hands that, you know, wore, you know, cool stage clothes and dry ice and the fog and all that. So it was just so explosions. And then I guess Van Halen 1, when that came out too, that really, that's when I went out and bought my first guitar. And so I don't know, I just had it all. I had it in me ever since I was a little kid, though. You know, I always had music. I always looked up to, you know, Elvis or whoever it was at the time. But I kind of knew all along that, I don't know, it just was in my heart to play music.
Cool. How about you, Frank?
Yeah, I had a similar experience. Just since I was a little kid, it was in me. I'm not even sure where it came from. It was just thinking back now, I had all kinds of paint cans and popping pans set up in my mother's basement and stuff that I used to whack the heck out of. And that was like when I was in the second grade, so I was very, very young. But I don't know. I remember wanting to be Keith Moon, basically, since the time I could remember anything. And I don't even know how that happened, but yeah, I had a whole set up like Keith Moon, and then when I got older, I bought everybody's drums in the neighborhood that they weren't using anymore, and I set up this like 20-piece drum set, all, you know, just to be like Keith Moon, and down at the John Bonham, and believe it or not, the Ted Nugent Cat Scratch Fever album was pretty big for me. I remember learning all of those songs off that record as soon as I got a drum set, and it just started early on. I think sometimes the people like us, like a fish to water, it just comes natural, you know. You don't even know exactly why you're doing it, you just start doing it, you know.
Right, very cool.
Keep on going.
So now, who would you guys say are your personal musical influences?
Myself, I've got so many. I really couldn't name, because they stretch not only from vocalist to guitarist, but even like Billy Sheehan, who's a bass player, but anybody that's a good musician. And there's thousands of them that really moved me. But I guess vocally, just to list a few, the top three, which is even hard to nail down, but it would be Halford and Dickinson and Dio. So, but like, again, there's so many who great, great musicians. And every day, even some of the newer bands, you see somebody up and coming, and you're like, wow, man, you guys good. Or, you know, Angel from Arch Enemy, that chick's good.
Oh, know? Yeah, yeah, yeah. So. Frank?
Oh, yeah. For me, it was really like John Bonham and Neil Peart, and as I already mentioned, Keith Moon. Those three drummers were, like, really pivotal and inspiring me. And then when I got older, it was called, you know, Clive Burr and Nico, of course. And, you know, I love Dave Lombardo. And I don't know, I think those five would probably be really, really big and influential in me. But I've also listened to a lot of the jazz guys. I used to listen to Buddy Rich and Gene Krupa and, you know, Rod Morgenstein, all the, you know, I got to the jazz fusion guys and all of that. It, I don't know, it just never ends. And like Joe said today, everywhere you turn, there's like excellent musicians, like just falling out of trees today. It's not like how it was 20-something years ago. There's a handful of good guys. Now right. It's like, everybody can play, you know, there's good players everywhere, so you're constantly just walking around wide-eyed and learning from this one and learning from that one and just trying to, you know, do your thing and, you know, contribute to the conversation if you can, you know?
Right, right, right. So now, when you guys aren't writing, touring, rehearsing, what do you guys do for a day off, man? What do you guys enjoy doing?
I like movies, I like just chilling. Yeah, it's basically, I also am a production manager for some bands, and so I'm on the road a lot, so even when I'm not playing with the band on the road or playing music and other bands on the road, I'm, you know, doing stuff within the music industry, and when I'm home, I just kind of like the veg, just chill, you know.
Frank?
I'm the complete opposite of that, you know, when I'm not working or rehearsing or doing any of that stuff, I'm really into, like, you know, outdoor stuff and extreme activities, be it parachuting, scuba diving, you know, rock climbing, anything that's extreme and dangerous and involves a lot of body, you know, a lot of cardiovascular or whatever. I don't like sitting around. I don't like vegging out. I mean, I have to do it sometimes to recharge my batteries and stuff, like, as we all do, but I'm very, like, antsy. I got a lot of energy that I don't know what to do with, and I ride my bicycle. I've even, like, gone back to skateboarding a little bit recently. I'm into martial arts. So, you know, I'm very active, you know, and anything. And the crazier and the nuttier, you know, the more I like it.
Very, very cool. So now, what would you guys say is your biggest rock star moment?
You know, I don't really like that kind of, you know, when I think of rock star, I think of Gene Simmons and Eddie Van Halen and Angus Young, you know what I mean? So I don't know where, if you're talking about with us, or you're talking about people that we, you know, our peers that we enjoy.
Either or, man, personal, with the band, or...
and tell you how much, you know, your music meant to them, and, you know, know, you hear comments like this album changed my life, and, you know, and I was really in a bad spot in my life, and I loved this song off the record. It really lifted my spirit. And when you hear stuff like that, you know, you might not feel like a rock star, but, you know, to me, that's what it's all about, you know, moments like that.
Cool, guys. Very cool. So now, let's take it the other way. You guys have any Spinal Tap moments you want to talk about? How do you compare this version of Leisure Lord to previous versions? I mean, have you grown? Have you evolved?
Immensely. you know, I think the major thing we had back then was that we were kids and we had the angst and we had the aggression and the, you know, the hunger to do it. Well, we still have that, but now we have years and years of refining our instruments and our craft and just becoming better at what we do. And, you know, I don't know, that actually, as I'm saying it, it sounds a little egotistical, but it's not. It's just anything that you do over a number of years and you dedicate yourself to it, you just get better at it, I think.
Right.
We're still
right.
All really, really healthy and we take care of ourselves. So, you know, like my voice is still there and the guys playing, all the guys playing, everyone's playing is still there. And we still have that aggression and that hunger, yet now we have maturity, and I think, I'm sure the band is so much tighter and well-oiled than it's ever been, than it could have ever been back then, which is a really exciting thing for us.
Very cool, very cool. So I think we just had someone else chime in.
Hey, man, it's Danny Wacker.
Hey, Danny, how you doing, man?
Good. A little hard to hear you, but I'm in the car right now driving. But, yeah, doing well.
Cool, man, cool. So, Danny, I'm talking to the guys here for a little bit. When did you first start playing, man? When did you know that this is what you wanted to do?
Probably, when I was a teenager, around 14 or 15, my mother and father were both musicians, so just growing up, I mean, physical family like that's always around it. I think I was 14 when I decided that I wanted to play guitar.
Cool, man, cool. So how'd you get involved with Leisure Lord?
Well, I had met Anthony about 10 years ago when he worked for DHT. And he had given me a call, I think it was in December, the 10th of December, when they needed a guitar player. He asked me if I was interested in, you know, coming up and learning some of the songs, seeing how it goes, which I did, and everything seems to work great. So that's kind of how it started.
Cool, man, cool. So who would you say your musical influences are, brother?
A lot of 80s metal, like Iron Maiden, Judas Priest, Ozzy, some of the Sevza earlier, like Black Sabbath, and, Van Halen, all the rock and the metal stuff is pretty much what I'm into.
Cool, cool. So now, I guess, here's a question for each of you. What advice would you have for bands just starting out?
Hey, this is Joe here. Everyone said that to me growing up, and it's true. It's not cliche. It's just stick to your guns. If it's really in your heart and soul, and it's a passion, it's just part of you, just don't ever give up. I mean, the main thing is if you're going to have success because you're talented or just because you get lucky, then you're going to have success, but you can't chase that road. You got to just do it because you love it, enjoy it. The rest will either come or it won't, but at least at the end of the day, if you're creating music you enjoy and love, you can be proud of it, and it's something tangible, that will never leave you. So just keep forging ahead, man. Just keep pushing.
Cool. Frank?
Yeah, I would definitely, I would echo those sentiments. Do it for the love of music. Don't do it for money, don't do it for fame, don't do it for women, or if you're a woman, don't do it for men, do it because you love music, because in the end, that's all that's really there. All of those other things kind of come and go, and flow in and flow out. One year you're popular, the next year you're not, one year all the girls love you, the next year they all hate you, and the thing is, you gotta just love the music, and really, really love it, because you'll find yourself in a lot of lonely, broke, desperate moments, and that's the only thing you got to hold on to, and you better love it, because, if you don't, then you're in a bad spot, and I've seen, a million guys who, walk the walk, and they, they dress the dress, and they said all the right things, but at the end of the day, they didn't have the total commitment and passion and love for music, and they just, those guys will fall by the wayside, so be honest about yourself, about why you're doing it, and just your eyes open.
Right. How about you, Danny?
I would say definitely take time to, practice and master your instrument. I when I was growing up, I used to play 8-9 hours a day. I tried to do it every day for years. And that's important as well, developing your craft.
Cool. Great advice, guys. So now, what would each of you like to see for Liege Lord?
Well, the shows have been just, we formed the band, and we've done what, guys, we've done 3 shows or something?
Yeah.
And it's met all my expectations, all my dreams of what I set up to start talking about reforming the band. And we just want to get on the road and tour and play as many shows and just keep moving ahead, and we also want to work on new music and take the band into the next step, the next phase of the band's career.
Cool. Frank?
Yeah, I would say pretty much the same thing. I mean, the band is relatively a reformed band. That's, the core members are there. Me and Danny are new, but there's a lot of chemistry, and it really clicked right out of the gate like a bunch of thoroughbreds, and we played a couple of shows. They've been fantastic, but I think all of us in our heart of hearts have this, we all probably feel inside that it could be even greater and bigger and get better. And, I just want to keep playing with these guys. They're really, really talented, experienced musicians that I'm enjoying. And I think we could just take it up a couple more notches and then hopefully do another record. And, and come out and make it a really strong one, and then go out all over the world and perform it, and have a party.
Cool. How about you, Danny?
We had 3 amazing shows so far, and I'm looking forward to doing some more touring, and definitely new music, and taking it as far as we can take it. It's a great group of guys. There's a great chemistry, and I'm having a great time.
Cool. Very cool. So, you guys have any upcoming shows?
Seymour, Connecticut, at Dewey's Pub on Friday, May 3rd. And for all your listeners to come out to that, as well as a very, very, very cool special, one night only in Manhattan on May 5th on Sunday at Webster Hall. Both shows are going to be killer. We want everyone to come down and make sure you're there because, we're going to do some stuff in June, but it might be till the fall until you see the band again. So get out next weekend, Friday in Connecticut, and Sunday at Webster Hall. Make sure you're there, and it's going to be a good time, man.
Very cool, very cool. So now, where can the listeners find Liege Lord?
Live or...
Like internet-wise, you guys, Facebook, you have a .com?
Yeah, we have Facebook, it's facebook.com/LiegeLordOfficial, Facebook page. We're working on a new website. LiegeLord.com is still owned by Paul Nelson, and it's not an official site. It hasn't been updated yet, so we don't do the math. So go to Facebook right now, check us out there, and then watch for the near future on our new website.
Very cool, very cool. Well, guys, the song I want to play today is Master Control. What can you tell us about that tune?
Master Control is about actually a machine or a robot, so to speak, that, you know, was supposed to do good for mankind, kind of took over itself and unleashed some fury on who created it and on mankind. So basically, it's pretty self-explanatory if you read the lyrics, and that's the best thing to do because you draw your own conclusions from it. But that's the title track of the third album, the one when I joined, and we've got that robot right there on the cover. Let's see.
Cool, cool. Well, Joe, Frank, Danny, I want to thank you guys for calling in today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Billy. Thanks for having us.
Oh, no problem. All right, listeners, check this out. This is Liege Lord with Master Control. We'll be right back.
Never die.